Present to you guys today someone that I know that can make a difference in your life. As I shared on the West Campus, he and I, we go back to grade school. So I've been knowing him over 50 years. Amen. And we came up together. We went in the street together. We went to the penitentiary together. We used crack together. We did all those things on that side. I'm just telling the truth. Is that all right? See, I believe in just telling the truth because we haven't always looked like we look today. We all haven't always been like we are today. How many know we all came from somewhere? How many know there's no such thing as big and little sin? How many realize that sin is sin? And the Bible says y'all have sin. Y'all did it. The Bible says that for we all have sinned and came with shorts. Some of y'all got it. Amen. You came with shorts. Amen. And God had to make up the difference for you. Amen. But today I just want to really just acknowledge this man. Like I said, we all came up together, him and I and his wife, and lived on the same block, went to the same school, all those things. And like I said, God got a hold of his life before he got a hold of mine. But when I was in the penitentiary the last time, the Lord got a hold of me, and I wrote a letter to him and another friend of mine and let them know that I was changed. But I know they was trying to check me out. You know, they didn't really believe it for real because y'all know I was the worst of the worst. Gonna tell the truth. But how many realize that God had totally and miraculously changed my life? May 14, 1986, for those that are not familiar, amen, 1986. So it's been over 32 years that the Lord saved me and changed my life. Amen. How many know God does a radical? He doesn't do a partial. When God is in it, how many know it's complete? Amen. And so I stand here today because of that. And I'm also here because of the love and the compassion and the sensitivity that he and his wife had for me and my wife. Amen. And they shared and they poured into our lives as we grew in our faith with the Lord. So I'm going to present to some this mighty man of God. His name is Apostle George Hutchison. I want you to stand and give him a great big round of applause. Amen.
Come on, you can do better than that for Jesus, can't you? Forget about me, give him some praise. Oh, come on, let's exalt his name together. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. He is good. He is wonderful. He is kind. He is merciful. He is forgiveness. He is joy. He is peace. Oh, come on and magnify him with me then today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Amen. 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 Well, we're just so glad to be here today. Back in the city of Minnesota. And my wife, she couldn't make it with me this time, but she says, much love. She's at home, but I'm just glad to be here for this occasion. It always gives my heart joy to drive either to fly to come here to see what God is doing in Minnesota. And then I'm glad for our friends, our dear friends, Bishop Earl and Pastor Pam, just dear friends of ours. We love her. Both of them so dearly. If you don't want them, we'll just take them back to Omaha with you. You know, I probably have to take Bishop Earl back, dragging and kicking. He ain't gonna go back. You know, but we just love you so much today. Glad to be at the river. I have so much history here. Just come to Minnesota, and this was the first house that we came to over on Selby Street. And like Bishop said, we came to check him out to see if it was for real or not. Amen. We found that it was the real deal Holyfield, though, when we got up here. And so we're just glad to be here today, just glad to be in the house of the Lord. This has been an awesome weekend. And over at the waters, and just a great thing that you're doing for your pastors, and not only for your pastors, but for this city, because everything you do for them, God's going to move it through them and touch this city, and the best is yet to come. I should sit down on that right there. The best is yet to come. You haven't seen anything yet.
Amen. Every young person in here should stand on your feet and sit back down and say, I'm waiting my turn. Come on. Because if it's going to come, it's going to be you. Amen. Amen, amen. Well, I won't keep you long today. I'm just going to say what the Lord has put on my heart for this time and here at you, share with you. If you have your Bibles, go with me to the book of Genesis, the 12th chapter. Genesis, the 12th chapter. And for those of you was at the service on Friday and Saturday, you know that this is the theme, plus we have it up on the screen. This is the theme scripture that was used. And as I said over at the waters with Pastor Kenzie and Pastor Jeff, Pastor Carol, they just didn't drip this dry. I mean, they didn't drain it dry. But I'm going to try to go in there and get a little something else out of it. What I mean by drain and dry, I mean they ministered so beautifully out of these verses of Scripture. And they didn't leave any stone unturned. And so I just want to echo what they were talking about. If you have it, just say amen. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, before he was Abraham, get thee out of your country. Get out of the city of Minnesota. You've been here too long. If you haven't done anything yet, you're not going to do nothing here. And from the kindred, sometime your family and your friends could be your biggest asset. And then at other times, they could be your biggest adversary. And from thy father's house, the place of comfort, the place where you've always had everything you needed. But I want to take you to a land that I will show thee. You don't know where you're going, but you'll know when you get there because I'll reveal it to you. And I will make thee a great nation of people coming out of you so that they can be the ones that receive what I'm promising you. And I will bless thee, and make thy name great. And I looked at that the other night, and I just was looking at that, and he said, I'll make thy name great. Sometimes we want to be great. But when you have a great name, it's there when you're gone. So he said, I'll make your name great. And thou shalt be a blessing. The theme this week is being blessed to be a blessing. And I want to just kind of tag on to that today and just use this for a text or for a topic this morning. Is what makes you a blessing? What makes you a blessing? I know that the Lord has given us in his word that we are blessed and highly favored. But what is it that makes you a blessing? Now, we find in the text today where he says, I'll make thy name great. But also, God created us. And he gave us things that, three things in particular, that will cause us to be successful ourselves, and then to be a blessing to others. And those three things are your ability, your creativity, and your productivity. The ability is that skill that God gave you, the gift that he gave you. It's the ability. That ability kind of ties up when the scripture says, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all you can ask or think, by the power or the ability that worketh within you. So that tells me that my blessing has already been put on the inside of me, and it's waiting to come out. And so here we find that ability is what God is going to use to not only bless you, but he's going to help you to be able to bless somebody else. And as I said this morning, blessing is not always monetary. See, blessing is when I can help you when you're in a time of need or when you're in a time of trouble. And you may not need money. Maybe you need a friend. Maybe you might have all the money that you need right now. But you need someone to listen to you and hear your voice, hear what you're saying, feel your pain. So this same ability allows us to do that. But then he also said that it was creativity. I said creativity. And creativity is my imagination. It's my ingenuity. It's the vision that God has given me. He's given old men dreams and young men visions, the Bible says. And so that creativity allows me to create some things that will cause me to be successful. And that will cause me not to only be successful for myself, but it'll cause me to leave an inheritance for my children's children. Is anybody listening to me? Because if I'm just blessed by myself, it's a lonely place to be in. But if I'm blessed and God can get it to me and get it through me and get it to somebody else, then when I leave, my name will be great. Come on, talk to me, somebody. And so here we find not only that, but then he gives us the ability, then he gives us the creativity, but it wouldn't work well if we didn't have the ability to be productive and to produce what we've thought about and what we vision and what we have created. I said this morning, there's some things that God placed in you. I'm coming your way. It was some things that God placed in you years ago when you were down maybe on Selby Street or down on Dale Street or around the community riding down this street out here, that beautiful street out there. And you rode by those homes and you said, "That's my house." Oh, come on, don't play with me. That's my car. You see what I'm saying? That's what God put down on the inside of you to give you the insight of where he wanted to take you and what he wanted you to have and what he wanted you to do with it. And so don't put the flame out. Just touch somebody and say, "Don't put the flame out." Come on. You can be 45 years old and still say that. "That's my house." So here it is. So these three components are what I call the blessing potential. It's what you can do but have not carried it out yet. See, there's a lot of things that's on the inside of you and on the inside of us that God is ready. He can't bless anybody else until we get in the place to where it's developed in us and it comes out of us, and then we can bless. That's why he told Abraham, he says, "Get you out from among your country. Get out from around familiar people. Get out from around blessing stealers. Get out from around people that you're comfortable with. Get out from around people that don't think you'll ever be anything. And if the only way you're going to be blessed is if they bless you. Get out from around those folk and come to a place where I'm going to show you." He said, "I'm going to bring you to a place where," and I know that, you know, when, let me say this, I'm going to throw this in for free. When Abraham, when God told him that, he had no idea that blessing included offering up Isaac. You see what I'm saying? If he saw that, he would have stayed in Ur, because this only boy Isaac, and he's got to offer him up. What kind of blessing is that? Amen. What kind of, God telling me to offer my only child, one that, you know, I couldn't have any children. Then my wife end up pregnant and give me a son. You know what I'm saying? And then if I have seen that 10, if he had seen that ahead of him, he never would have left Ur, because he wouldn't have saw the end of the picture. I don't care. I'm talking to somebody now. He wouldn't have been able to see beyond him offering Isaac and God providing a ram. See? So here it is. So those three components, that's the ability that is lying dormant that has to be released. Amen. Tell somebody, say, "You need to be released." I know. Where you at right now, you think you're doing pretty good. Everything is going well. But baby, you need to be released. You need to be released to the next level. You need to be released to the next dimension. You need to be released to the next phase of your life. Your potential is not exhausted yet. Your potential is just being tapped into now. You're in the entryway of where God is about to take you, and you got to let God stretch you. Hey, So here it is. Because I'm ambitious to set me down. Here it is. So it says, God is not, now watch this. God, this is how God is going to get it to us so that we can get it to somebody else. And I thank God for my grandson. He's 15 now. He rode up here with me, you know, and all the time he's been with me, I've been just talking to God about, Lord, how am I going to pass this on to him? How am I going to pass this on to him? How am I going to be able to get in between where he's at now and open the door to his future so that he can peek? I want to be like the prophet told the young man that was with him. He said, oh man, we're surrounded by potential killers. We are surrounded by blessing killers. He said, but God, let him see. Open his eyes so that he can look down and see what you have provided for us. There's more with us than there are with him. Come on, there's more in you than you can even imagine. There's more that's crying to get out of you. I've got to stretch out of you. So here it is. So now, when I thought about that, then I thought about this. God is not as excited about your ability as he is your potential. Say that again. He knows that you're a superstar. He knows that now you're young and strong. But potential outlasts ability. Come on. See, potential, that means that it's a constant turnover. It's a constant turnover in life. And your ability, because, yeah, you bling, bling now. You 36, 32, and 22 and all that stuff. But 40 years from now, you're not, somebody should say, amen, help me. Do I have to, I just raise up land. But your potential, God never looks at what you're doing now. He always looks for what you're going to do tomorrow. Abraham, I've given you the land even though you haven't been there yet. I've given you the land even though you don't even know where you're going. How many people in here right now, you don't really know? I know you're super spiritual like me, and I've been knowing what the Lord is going to do. But no, you don't know what God's going to do with you tomorrow. You don't know. You might have some ideas. You might have some desires, but you don't know what tomorrow brings. That's why the Bible says, take heed for things of today, because tomorrow is really not promised to us. So if you gonna do it, let your potential be stretched today. Amen. That way, even if you don't get there, your potential will give you a picture of where you're going. Woo, Jesus. Glory be to God. So now I didn't throw this in this morning, but I'm gonna throw it into you guys because y'all look like y'all a little bit sharper than over in water. I'm just there it is. See, you can always visit your potential to be a blessing on the screen of your mind. I see myself. I do, Bishop. I see myself. When I see a person with a need, I see myself walking up and just writing them a $50,000 check. You know, I see myself saying, hey, listen, you and those kids, you need a house. And just going to the bank, not talking about getting a 30-year loan, but just writing them a check. Amen. Writing them out. How do you want to pay for this, sir? Cash. I want to pay for it cash. I said I want to pay for it cash. And you know, God gives us glimpses of it all the time, but sometimes we can become so heavenly minded we're no earthly good. And God is letting people like the boxer, what's his name? The little guy, call him money. What, help me preach somebody. Mayweather come in with a briefcase full of money. I mean a duffel bag full of money. And then the other guy, rapper T, whatever his name, he comes in, got a briefcase full of money. Talking about, I'm going to buy you a car. I'm going to buy you a whatever you want. Now, how come the people of God, who the Lord owns everything, the cattle on 1,000 hills, all the earth belong to him. All the silver belong to him. All the gold belong to him. All the diamonds belong to him. Now, why can't we walk in and with a briefcase full of money and got two security guards on both sides saying, who can I bless today? You see, but you got to visit there. You know, you got to visit there. I'm not going back to welfare no more. I'm not going back to the projects. You ain't going to find me in the projects no more. I'm sorry about that. I'm not going to get no commodity food no more. My vision now says, George, I heard Pastor Arnold say this one time. I had some money. I've been broke. And then I had some money. I like having money better. I've lived in the projects, and now I got my house way out yonder. And I like living out yonder better. Come on, talk to me, somebody. But you got to stir yourself up. You got to stir your dream up. You got to stir your gift up and say, poverty, you cannot have dominion over me. Come on, put your hands together right there, right there, right there. Here it is. Here it is. God always recognizes your next phase of potential before you do. Did you get that? He always recognizes it before you do. You singing up here now, but you singing here. You happy to come up here and minister for the Lord, minister to the people, but you don't see yourself at the BET Awards yet. Are you hearing me? You don't see yourself the one that's bringing God to the BET. Here come God's man coming to the BET. We're going to shut down some of this stuff and bring the glory of God in here, because I have the potential to change stuff. I have the potential to change songs. I have the potential to change music. I have the potential to change other people, because demand and supply go along together. Amen. If you are in demand, somebody going to supply what your requests are. And I request that you don't curse around me when I'm singing. Don't smoke no cigarettes, don't drink no beer, and don't be putting me in the green room with nobody that don't want to know nothing about Jesus, because that's what I come to do, is to present Jesus, is to bring him up out of my spirit and bring him to the world so that the world can be better. If I can get everybody saved, I don't have to pray so long. If I can get everybody saved, I can walk down the street and leave my door open. That's what I... Here it is. Here it is. Here it is. He always know, God, where you're going before you get started. We have that where he told Abraham, just get out. Sometimes you just get out. I remember when I was 18, I wanted to do whatever I wanted to do. And my mama told me, just get out. Get out while you know everything. Let's look at somebody and tell them, say, just get. And so in this text, we almost friends. In this text, 1 Samuel 3, God gives us a picture of what he means by he knows it and recognize your potential before you do. You see. There are a lot of people in the dugout that really need to be at the plate. Are you understanding what I'm saying? But sometimes they're just scared. I went to see a movie the other day. Oh, yeah, I go every once in a while. I go every once in a while. But I took my grandson was here, so we went to see that movie, Uncle Remus. Or what was his name? Uncle Drew. But my point, I'm trying, y'all. I'm trying. I really am. I'm trying. I'm God given. But my point is that there was a character there where a guy had missed a big shot, got his shot blocked by another guy, and it tore down his desire to become a professional. He relented to just being a coach, when he really could have been a player. And do you know, sometimes in the church, we like that. We, you know, sometimes just because the devil blocked our shot one time.
And God then, God has already told us that we are blessed and highly favored. But I take a jump shot and the devil puts it back in my face one time. And now I don't even want to get in the game no more. It's hard for me to come to church anymore. It's hard for me to hear. Now, I was listening to all Christian music on my CD in my car. Now I'm listening to a little, you know, this and a little that. Come on here. Come here with me. I'm going, you know, because my shot got blocked. But let me tell you something. Just because he blocked your shot, that doesn't mean he wins the game. Oh, you understand? Because can I help somebody in here today? This might be the only thing I can say to help you. You ready for this? I said, are you ready for this? I come to tell you that the fight is fixed. Yeah. You couldn't lose if you want to lose because the fight is already fixed. God already has it planned for you. You're going to be the one that break the tape. You're going to be the one that stand up there giving the power sign. You're going to be the one because even if you don't want to do it, but God says, I've called you to do it. There's something you can't back out of because God's not going to let you back out of it. And you, even though you want to try to hang out here and there, but God's not going to let you do it. Am I talking to somebody in here? Let me get with this and we'll finish. Two verses of scripture. Well, three. Here in 1 Samuel 3 and 18, notice what it says. And you know this scripture. As Samuel was called by God, you know, his mother had took him to the temple. And Eli was the priest there in the temple. And Eli was the priest, but Eli and all of his sons in the temple was backslid. Amen. And whenever there was no open word from the Lord, no open vision, nothing. They would come. Can I help somebody? Let me help myself first. We were coming to church every Sunday, coming to prayer and Bible study, 12 steps, coming there too. But there was no open vision. In other words, we were just having church, but God never showed up. But God never leaves his people without someone to bring the blessing. And he raised up Samuel and sent Samuel to Eli. Well, Eli had been letting his sons cruise the choir stand, hitting on all the honeys, taking all the tide and spinning the tides on his head. He walking around with boss suits on and you know, and gator shoes on his sons. They walking around there. The church, they bad starving like Marvin around there. And he went, but God sent a deliverer. He sent Samuel to Eli. And when Samuel came in, Samuel didn't know anything. He was just innocent. He just coming in. He just glad to be saved. Like that brother today came up and said, I don't know what y'all talking about, but praise the Lord, I'm saved. Amen. I don't know what to do. I don't know all John 3:16. I don't know the five dimensions of the third level of the Holy Ghost, but I do know that I'm saved. Amen. I do know that God done changed my life. Amen. I knew that there's light on the house now in the name of Jesus. Somebody put your hands together and give God a praise. Here it is. So he says to him, I'm starting at the 9th verse. Then, therefore, Eli said to Samuel, go lie back down. The Lord called him. He said, go lie back down. And it shall be, if he calls thee, that thou shalt say, speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth. So Samuel went and laid down in his place. And the Lord came and stood and called as at other times, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel answered, speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth. What am I saying here? I'm saying that Samuel had no idea what God was getting ready to do in his life. He had no idea that he was going to be the one that anoint the king of Israel. He had no idea that he'd have to take out Agag and all of them because Saul backslid. He had no idea about it, but God took him to a place where there was nobody preaching right, where nobody was living right. That's why I don't care what they're doing in the church. You just live. Are you hearing me? Forget all this stuff. They ain't living right up there. They ain't doing nothing right up there. Them folk up there. No, you just get to the place that God is calling you. You answer, here am I, Lord. If don't nobody else want to live right, I live right. Here it is. So there are some hindrances. Let me give you these and we'll go. Some hindrances. There's some things that'll keep you, even though you're blessed, highly favored, and God has already given you the blessing. You're not going to be blessed. Hello? You're not going to be. God is never going to do anything. He knows the end from the beginning. And he done been there and back and got 3 t-shirts. I know some of y'all saying, he's just messing that gospel up, man. But what I'm saying is this, is that God is not going to do anything. He's already blessed you. He blessed you. And the thing about it is he's blessed you. And sometimes the enemy will come in and try and deceive us and cause us to think that what God says is not true. Am I right? Am I right about that? He'll start telling you know, just because you see so-and-so got it, that don't mean you can get it. You remember where you came from. You was in prison. You was in prison and you was on drugs and you was all that. Look at you. You was just, but you know why I always ask the devil, Pastor? I look at that slew-footed joker and I tell him, I say, let me ask you something. Since I've been saved, what do you have on me now? Y'all better listen to me. Since I've been washed in the blood, since I've been into the kingdom of God, look at your record and tell me, what do you see on there now? The stuff you charging me about, the court, the high court, has already released me from that. I've already got a reprieve from that. Now, if you want to find something that you can charge me with, you got to look at my new record. You got to look at my marriage now, not before I got saved. You got to look at my children now, not before I got saved. You got to look at my righteousness now, not before I got saved. And I'm telling somebody in here today, you just tell the devil and his grandmama, if you can't tell me nothing on me now, don't be messing with me. Here it is. 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 Because this is what happened. Most time, what turns us back is that our last successful project. Come on. Our last successful project. We still living on that. You hear people saying it all the time. I remember, sometime I be with my pastors, and I know what they're saying. They say, yeah, I remember back when I used to have my church over on 78, so-and-so, and man, we had a nice choir, and we had a nice this, and we had a nice that, and I'm sitting up there listening to him, and he's saying, yeah, I remember back then, and they living on past victories. And past victories has already been exhausted. So I've got to allow God to wake up on the inside. I got to allow the Holy Ghost to wake up on the inside of me so that I can get new visions for new lands, for new places, for new people, for new things, for new God things, new things that God wants me to do. I've got to shake myself. Whew. Here it is. Let me give you just one verse of scripture. I won't turn here, but y'all, for the sake of time, in Luke, the 18th chapter, you remember the rich young ruler. Yeah, he came to Jesus and said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? When he came to Jesus and said that, and then he called him and all that, blah, blah, blah. But if I check your Rolodex, if I check your Facebook page, there's some people in there where every time you see them, I see you back there, bro, every time you see them, you put one of the mean faces up there. And God is saying, listen, you guys fell out some time ago, but they didn't got. She's saved now. She's in the kingdom of God now, and last week. Something happened where she inherited some money. Her grandfather down in Mississippi had 10,000 acres of land, and she didn't know that it was her land. And now she sold all the trees off the land, and she's filthy rich. But she remembered that she had offended you and that she had done you wrong. And I spoke to her in her spirit, just like I speak to you in your spirit, to go back and make amends with your sister or your brother. And when you see them coming, sometimes we be like the prodigal son, oldest brother. Why you let them come back in? Kill the fatted calf for them. Let them have a ring and all that stuff. I'll tell you why. Because he's getting ready to be a blessing to you.
Here it is. Last one. And this is one right here. We're going to go on this one, because this is what almost got me. Sometimes our blessings are hung up and we can't bless ourselves. We can't receive the blessing that God has given us, I should say, and pass it on. It's because we become a slave to tradition and old ways of doing things. Come on. We can't get a new piano because grandma bought that piano over there. Nobody played it for 20 years, but it ain't going nowhere. It's not going anywhere because I become a slave to tradition and old way of doing things. Man, they got keyboards now that play all the things. I mean, you take that keyboard, play all the things, got drums on there. You know, you used to have a drummer, then you got to have a bongo player and all that. If you get you a good keyboard player like that brother is right there, you get you a good, he'll play piano. Man, you think John P. Key up in this place, man. But we get stuck in old ways of doing things. And it causes our blessing to pump its brakes. And I'm going to close with this scripture here so we can get that in Luke 10:38. It says, now it came to pass as they went, talking about Jesus and his disciples. This is when Lazarus, but I want to throw Lazarus in there in a minute. But now it came to pass as they went, that he entered into the certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. Now, this is the same Martha and Mary that Lazarus' sisters. Somebody say amen. Theologians? Amen. And this is the one where Lazarus had died and was in the grave. And Jesus and his disciples was chilling. What you mean chilling, Pastor? I mean, they weren't in a rush to get there. And they were there, and they stayed around. Jesus hung around for, I think it was 3 days, close to 3 days or something like that. Y'all help me if I'm wrong. Just read it, this and that. But he hung around because he knew that their situation wasn't as bad as they thought it was. And he knew that the blessing couldn't get to their house until Jesus got there, because he came in with the blessing falling behind him, not the blessing in front of him. He says, Lazarus is going to be all right. He said, this sickness is not to death. Why? Because when I get there, everything in their lives is going to change. But on my point that I want to make, here it is. It says in verse 40, But Martha was cumbered. She was just excited, over enthused, just round the house, cleaning, vacuuming. How about shata babasa? How about dusting the curtains and just doing stuff? You know, because we get used to doing stuff when God trying to get us to do ministry.
And so she was around there doing all that stuff and cleaning and making cornbread and, you know, preparing for him to come in. You know, I mean, she had to probably had the bucket of water by the steps there, by the front door, so that she could scrub Jesus' feet down and the disciples' feet down, amen, and bring them on in. But she was much cumbered. And sometimes when we get real cumbered like that, when we get real busy, just busy, 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 wake up in the morning. Can I help somebody? Wake up in the morning. I'll be the first one to go. Wake up in the morning, and before you know it, three people didn't call you. Somebody need a ride to the hospital. Then somebody need to be picked up from the post office. And then somebody need for you to take them down to the grocery store. And then Auntie Nem is stuck downtown. So now I can't spend any time with God. And I'm saying, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Bang, 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 bang. And I'm much cumbered. But look at the next verse. Look at the next verse. It says, and Jesus answered to her and said to her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. You're troubled. You're vexed. You're troubled. But now notice what he said in verse 32. But the one thing is needful. And Mary has chosen that good part. In other words, he said, you know, not throwing no bad shout on Mary, anything like that, Martha, anything like that, but he says, I'm in the house and I bring my anointing and my blessings with me. The curtains are going to stay here. The dog going to need feeding tomorrow. The snow going to need shoveling next week. But I'm here now. I come bearing gifts right now. And Mary has looked at it like she's supposed to look at it. And she sees what the possibilities are for her now. And so she has taken the thing that chosen the good part, which shall be not taken away from her. Her blessing is not going to be taken away because she's real busy. In my conclusion, in order for us to be successful and be able to bless somebody else, these things here are some things that we should consider. Because once we get these in line, we'll find that the blessing will flow. Yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. You see what I'm saying? Because God is with me. You know what I mean? I know he says Africa, you know, but he's with me. And let me tell you, wherever God is, that's where the blessing is. Take everything away from me that you want to. Take my car, take my house, take everything you want to take away from me. But please, ma'am, please, sir, if you don't want to fight, don't try to take Jesus. Don't try to take Jesus. Don't try to take Jesus away from me, because he's too important. He's too beautiful. He's too great. He's too mighty. He's too wonderful. He's too awesome. He's too magnificent. He's too great. He's everything to me. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, come on, come on. Put them together. Yeah, 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 yeah. I see blessings flowing right now. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Somebody's going to go back home and some things going to be changed for you right now. You press your way to church today. You almost missed, didn't even get here today. But I tell you, by the Spirit of the Holy Ghost, I hear God saying, when you get back, things are going to change. They're going to be different. They're going to be new. They're going to turn around. They're going to be restored. They're going to be renewed. They're going to soar like eagles for you now. Somebody, who am I talking to in here? You left home. You were upset when you left home. Come down here right quick. I got something for you. Come down here right quick, real quick. Don't sit down on it. Just come on, come on, come on. Oh, God, I hear you, I hear you, I hear you. I hear you, I hear you. Come on now. I ain't going to make no long appeal, because I got to go. We got to go. We got a time. We got a time. We out of time. But somebody in here today, you going through something. And when you left home, you just left home. You say, I'm just going to church anyway. And God says, I was calling you to the place that I'm going to show you. I was calling you to the place that I'm going to show you. Oh, shana de lobo shata. Ilebo shanda babasa. Yeah, I'm calling you to a higher place. I'm calling you to a higher calling. I'm calling you to a place where you don't have to be concerned about those issues anymore. Ah, is that you? That you? Come on, come on, come on, come on.